Good morning. Now you can hear me. Good morning. Thank you for your patience this morning. It is ironic that our theme for today is what are you worth? Because right now our musicians are worth $1 million. Carla called me at 9 o'clock throwing up. So she was supposed to play today, obviously. Peg had eye surgery, can't see past the end of her nose. So Peg, you are still worth $1 million, but not to play today. And Connie is not able to be here. She is with her mother-in-law helping out. So Richard, who is now worth $1 million, well, we always knew Richard was worth $1 million, plus, what? $2 million. Richard, and when I went to get on YouTube to pull like some karaoke music down or something, yeah, the internet wasn't working. I think we're supposed to do a cappella, but luckily we have some just really solid, great, more contemporary music today that I really wanted to sing. So Richard is going to be playing on his phone so that we can hear the music and sing along with the singers. So it will be wonderful. So thank you for your patience and your understanding. I'll get some of those kinks worked out so that when it happens again, I'll hope Richard is in worship. Let's see, Wednesday morning at 7:45, if you can be around, meet at the post office for the walk to school. Picture, it is National Walk to School Day nationwide. That's why Wednesday morning was chosen. Because nationally, that is the walk to school today. So if you can come walk with the kids, that would be great. Pictures will be taken in support of the grant that the town is writing to try to get some more sidewalks in. So I really have to give my hats off to Joan and others for the work that they do in writing the grants, because I think most of the sidewalks that are in town are because of the work that they have done on grants. So they're working to try to get more sidewalks in so that there is safety for our children and ourselves as we walk to school and walk around town and bike around town. For those of you who live in town, who worship, who go to the grocery store, they are continuing to look for letters of support that they can turn in with their grant presentation in November. So if you're willing to write a letter, just come visit with me and I will tell you what to do. I already have mine submitted. Let's see. Potluck after worship. So please plan on staying for that. If you didn't bring anything, that's okay. Like I say every month, loaves and fishes, the food just seems to multiply to have enough to serve everyone. So hopefully you are able to stay for that. And yeah, read what is in the bulletin for announcements. We kind of skipped ahead a week because it's the fifth Sunday. So next month's Mission of the Month is printed in the bulletin. We are also working on the newsletter, which will come out tomorrow. Today's mission is still our Battle Creek Fire Department. So anything that you put in the globe or write Mission of the Month on the check will still go this week to the Battle Creek Fire Department. And thank you for your continued support and generosity of all of our missions of the month. I think this year, was it over $6,000? I was trying to remember, that'll go in the newsletter, that has been generously donated for our various missions of the month this year already. So thank you. Thank you very much. And thank you, Butch, for the beautiful rain system that now the rain no longer ends up on the driveway or down the side of the church. Much appreciated. It looks great. And I know it was a lot of hard work. He wanted me to help dig a trench. He didn't realize I have no upper body strength, so I might have begged off of that one. With that being spoken, let's take a minute to breathe in and breathe out as we hear the ringing of the bell.
Thank you.
rise as we sing hymn number 858. We're going to sing the words that are on the PowerPoint and the hymnal, even if it doesn't match the words the singers are singing. Hallelujah, praise the Lord, O my soul.
I will praise the Lord as long as I live. I will sing praises to my God while I have my being.
Put not your trust in rulers, in mortals in whom there is no help.
When they breathe their last, they return to earth, and in that day their thoughts perish.
Happy are they who have the God of Jacob for their help, whose hope is in the Lord their God.
Who made heaven and earth, the seas, and all that is in them, who keeps promises forever.
Who gives justice to those who are oppressed and food to those who hunger. The Lord sets the captive free.
The Lord opens the eyes of the blind. The Lord lifts up those who are bowed down. The Lord loves the righteous.
The Lord cares for the stranger. The Lord sustains the orphan and widow, but frustrates the way of the wicked.
The Lord shall reign forever. Your God will shine throughout all generations. Hallelujah.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Holy God, you reach out in love through Jesus Christ to save us so that we may live as faithful servants of you alone. Unchain us from our desire for wealth and power so that we may, in turn, release others from the prisons of poverty, hunger, and oppression. Amen. With you all. Let us share a sign of God's peace with one another. God's peace be with you. God's peace. God's peace. God's peace. God's peace. God's peace. Good morning. I would then invite you to be seated as we hear our first reading.
Sam, Roger. Good morning. Thank you, Tim Roger. The scripture reading this morning comes from 1 Timothy chapter 6 and the verses 6 through 19.
Can't hear you.
Oh, you can't. Are we on?
Yes.
Okay, then I'll get in closer.
There you go.
So it's coming from 1 Timothy chapter 6. Of course, there is great gain in godliness combined with contentment. For we brought nothing into the world, so we can take nothing out of it. But if we have food and clothing, we will be content with these. But those who want to be rich fall into temptation and are trapped by many senseless and harmful desires that plunge people into ruin and destruction. For the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil, and in their eagerness to be rich, some have wandered away from the faith and pierced themselves with many pains. But as for you, man of God, shun all this. Pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, endurance, and gentleness. Fight the good fight of the faith. Take hold of the eternal life, to which you were called and for which you made the good confession in the presence of many witnesses. In the presence of God, who gives life to all things, and of Christ Jesus, who in his testimony before Pontius Pilate made the good confession, I charge you to keep the commandment without spot or blame until the manifestation of our Lord Jesus. Of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he will bring about at the right time. He who is the blessed and only sovereign, the King of kings, the Lord of lords. It is he alone who has immortality and dwells in unapproachable light, whom no one has ever seen or can see. To him be honor and eternal dominion. Amen. As for those who in the present age are rich, command them not to be haughty or to set their hopes on the uncertainty of riches, but rather on God, who richly provides us with everything for our enjoyment. They are to do good, to be rich in good works, generous, and ready to share, thus storing up for themselves the treasure of a good foundation for the future, so that they may take hold of the life that really is life. The word of the Lord.
And live.
I think I saw Jace come in back there. Did you want to help me out today, Jace? Would you like to do that? Good, because I could use a hand. Have you ever been to a rummage sale or a garage sale or went somewhere where somebody had a whole bunch of stuff out and they were selling it and you looked around to see if there's any cool toys so you could buy them? No? Haven't had that experience yet? Should we ask these people out here, any of you have had that experience? Okay, turn around, let's look at them. See if anybody went to a rummage sale or garage sale before. Have them raise their hands. All right, who should we talk to about rummage sales and garage sales, do you think? Anybody in particular? No? How about Gloria? She's right up front. Should we talk to her? Yeah? Okay, we'll go talk to Gloria. But wait, you need to help me carry things, because let's pretend we're going to have a rummage sale at church, so we have to price stuff, right? We have to figure out what it's worth. So if we were going to sell this globe, what kind of a price tag do you think we should put on it? Look, I got my tape, I got my marker. Now, remember, it's not just your basic glass bowl. The world-famous artist Adair Dears has painted on this. So that has to be worth something, right? So if you wanted to buy this, how much would you buy it for? You don't know? Should we put a dollar on it? $2? What do you think? $1, you think? Okay, that's a pretty good price. We can put $1 on it. I think Adair's work might be worth more, but I'll go with a dollar. Okay, how about this lovely vase that you put flowers in? You know what? Did you see what price is on there? That's a $5. It's $5. Would you pay $5 for this vase? I wouldn't pay $5 for this vase. What would you pay for this vase? $100, you think? Holy cow, this vase is worth a lot of money. Good job, Jace. We're going to put that on that one, okay? $100, anybody wants this vase? Okay? How about this strawberry snow cone flavoring? So if you shave some ice, you could put this on it and it would be like strawberry snow cones. Do you like snow cones? Yeah? Do you think you can shave some ice at your house? You can't? How about mom or dad? Or Taylor? I have an ice shaver at my house. You want to borrow it? No? Well, how much do you think you would pay for this if it meant you could have a snow cone? $40. Okay. That is quite a bargain, because snow cones, when it's 100 degrees, are worth $40. All right. Look, I got the ball out. What do you think? I actually found this at a secondhand store, which is kind of like a big rummage sale. What do you think you would pay for this?
$100
for this too? $400 for this. I might sell it to you for $400. I'd have to think about it, though. Okay, we got $400 for this. How about the sloth? Now, this means a lot to me. I happen to like sloths. $100 for the sloth. Okay, now how about if I was going to sell you? What kind of value should I put on you? Okay, I'm going to sell Jace. What kind of value does Jace have?
None?
I don't agree with that. I'm going to put M-A-O on there. Make me an offer. Okay, we're going to make me an offer for Jace. Because you, I think, are worth a lot. And you...
$500.
See, Roger's going to give $500 for you. Do you think you're worth more than that? Yeah, I think you are. Ask your mom and dad, are you worth more than $500?
Sometimes.
I think all the time. I think all the time. You know who else thinks you're worth more than any amount of money? God. God thinks you are worth more than any amount of money could ever buy. No matter what kind of price tag we put on anything else, God thinks you are absolutely priceless because he loves you that much. And really, if it came down to it, I'm pretty sure mom and dad and grandpa would think you were priceless too. I can't believe grandpa didn't jump in and overbid Roger for you. I tell ya, how about if we pray? Good and gracious God, we thank you that we are worth way more than any price tag. And God, I just ask you to bless our children, those who are here and those who are not in this building, God, because sometimes they answer like Jace, that they aren't worth anything, and we know they are worth the world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, I hid the candy under here. I think two pieces today, because you had to do so much today. What do you think? Okay, you got it. You can head on back to your seat. Thank you so much, Jace. I appreciate your help. I really will sell this vase for $100, by the way. Right in the offering plate. But the sloth and the ball, they're not for sale. We continue reading in our gospel text, Luke. We are on the 15th chapter, beginning with the... that's not right. That's where I was reading beforehand. How about the 16th chapter, beginning with the 19th verse? To set it up, I would like to read just a few verses before that. Now, last week we heard about the parable of the dishonest manager, and Jesus has been using a multitude of parables to try to teach us about a variety of things that have been really uncomfortable to hear. This week is no exception to that. Verse 14 says, the Pharisees, who were lovers of money, heard all this, and they ridiculed Jesus. So Jesus said to them, you are those who justify yourselves in the sight of others, but God knows your hearts, for what is prized by human beings is an abomination in the sight of God. Then there's some more verses, and then Jesus continues. There was a rich man who was dressed in purple and fine linen and who feasted sumptuously every day. And at his gate lay a poor man named Lazarus, covered with sores, who longed to satisfy his hunger with what fell from the man's table. Even the dogs would come and lick his sores. The poor man died and was carried away by the angels to be with Abraham. The rich man also died and was buried. In Hades, where he was being tormented, he looked up and saw Abraham far away with Lazarus by his side. And he called out, "Father Abraham, have mercy on me and send Lazarus to dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am in agony in these flames." But Abraham said, "Child, remember that during your lifetime you received your good things and Lazarus in this manner evil things. But now he is comforted here and you are in agony. Besides all this, between you and us, a great chasm has been fixed so that those who might want to pass from here to you cannot do so, and no one can cross from there to us." He said, "Then, Father, I beg you to send him to my father's house, for I have five brothers, that he may warn them so that they will not also come into this place of torment." Abraham replied, "They have Moses and the prophets. They should listen to them." He said, "No, Father Abraham, but if someone goes to them from the dead, they will repent." And he said to him, "If they do not listen to Moses and the prophets, neither will they be convinced, even if someone rises from the dead." The word of the Lord. Grace and peace to you from God, our Father, and from Jesus, our Savior. Amen. So if I asked you the question, what are you worth? Where would your brain first go?
Financial.
Okay? Because a lot of people wonder, you know, what is my net worth, right? What am I worth? I can guarantee you I am worth way more if I was to die and my life insurance would kick in. Because I'm pretty sure right now I'm in the negatives as far as my net worth goes. How about the rest of you? What are you worth? What else might kick in?
Like the idea that the sum of our worth is in what we're putting out there and what we're doing.
The sum of our worth is what we're putting out there and what we're doing. I like that. So then with that thought process, I ask you, what are you worth? What are you worth as a person?
A friend to somebody?
Carol, I'm pretty sure you're a friend to a lot of people. I will proclaim that you're good. Amen. Be careful of that raising of the hand stuff. We don't do that in the Lutheran church. I'm going to corrupt you yet, Carol. That's right. Think about it. What are you worth? That question gets asked all the time of us in today's society in multiple different ways. And usually, the what are you worth, they are asking about something tangible. Your net worth, they might be asking about your skills or your abilities. They might be wondering about if you have a vehicle and transportation, if you are smart enough, if you are skinny enough, if you are beautiful enough, if you are handsome enough, if you have the right clothes, if you have the right shoes, because in today's society, that all determines your worth, according to some. Even if you are the right skin color, the right gender, that determines your worth to some people. And we see that question in the big picture, even being asked by Jesus in this parable. Because we have a rich man, and we have the poor man Lazarus, who has leprosy, which, if you remember, means that he has been shunned by the entire village. He is forced to sit outside the gate. He cannot even come into the gate at night for protection. He lays there as people walk over him day after day after day. What do people think he is worth? And then there's the rich man, who is probably one that has walked over him day after day after day, whose love for money has blinded him to everything else. And if you asked him, my guess is the rich man would have said, I am priceless. I am worth so much. Look, I have my purple clothes on, which is a sign of wealth and royalty. I live in a big house. I have 5 brothers. My family will go on and on and on. I am worth a lot, and I'm pretty sure that rich man was pretty sure he was going to go to heaven when he died. What are you worth? The poor man, Lazarus, this is not the same Lazarus that was raised from the grave. In this parable, now remember, this is a story that Jesus is telling. In this parable, poor Lazarus goes to heaven and is met by his father, Abraham, because Jesus has not died yet, so Abraham is then and now today still the father of the church. And he is welcomed, and I can envision him being washed clean and clothed and fed. And all of a sudden, this man who felt he had no worth is part of the highest worth ever, sitting with Father Abraham. And this rich man who thought he was worth a lot is now in hell being tormented. And he calls up, and to him, Lazarus is still not worth even talking to. So he says to Abraham, would you make Lazarus go do this? Because in his eyes, Lazarus was still a step below himself. Send him as my slave to do this, to give me some water, to talk to my brothers. Then Abraham says, no. It's really not worth it. Because guess what? Your brothers, they have the prophets. They already know the law. They already should understand how they should be living their lives and who they should be worshiping. But if they're anything like you, this is my thought process, obviously. If they're anything like you, they are not worshiping the God of our fathers. They are not worshiping Yahweh. Instead, they are worshiping money. Because being worth financial gain and power and control is much more important to you than seeing the person lying in the gate on the ground. Because of your love for money and your love for power and your love for material possessions, because that is where you found your worth, you became blind to everyone you could help with what you have been blessed with and with what you have been commanded to be stewards of. And so every single day when you went in and out, you walked over Lazarus and never offered to help, never gave him anything, in fact, considered him, the dirt on the road. You were blind to the need. And if you can't follow and worship the God that you already know about, having someone rise from the dead is not going to help, because you won't listen to them either. Kind of prophetic on Jesus' part, right? So then we go back to 1 Timothy. Has one of the most top 10 misunderstood, misquoted quotes of the Bible. For the love of money is the root of all evil. Or, as some people like to say, for the love of money is evil. Or, wait, for money is evil. That's not what he's saying at all. You see, Paul is writing to this young kid, this teenager who's going out and proclaiming the word of God and teaching and starting and building churches. And Paul is saying to him, it's not money that is evil. Unlike what some Christians want to believe, that money means that you're just an awful person, that's not it at all. It's what are you worshiping? How do you look at the worth of others? Do they need to be of the same social class, the same race, the same belief, the same lifestyle as you for them to be considered worthy? Or do you consider yourself better than anyone else, and therefore everyone else who cannot meet your standards, they are worthless? And you will walk over them, and you will not see them, and you will not use the resources that you have been given to help them. That is when money becomes evil, when possessions become hurtful, when you focus on having more and more and more, and then pretty soon, when one can't keep up, they feel worthless. Even when they are surrounded by the biggest and the best toys you could have. Because they have worshipped what they are able to get instead of worshiping God. Because guess what? It is in God that we are worthy. God has already called us worthy. God has already said, you are my child. You are created in my image. You are full of worth, no matter what anybody else tells you. No matter what the stock markets do, no matter if it rains or it doesn't rain, no matter if you have brand new clothes or hand-me-downs or rummage sale clothes, no matter if you understand math or don't understand math, no matter if you can read or write, no matter if you can paint or not paint, no matter if you can drive a tractor or if all you can drive is a bicycle, you are worthy. You are full of worth. God has given you all that you need so that your eyes can be opened to those around us who do not feel worthy. So that we can use the gifts and resources that we have been given to help those who get stepped over by society, who get pushed to the sides. We have the ability to break down the chasms, the walls, the schisms, everything else that keeps us from being in relationship with God and God's creation and God's people. We all have little prejudices, all of us, including myself, and sometimes we don't even realize that they are there until we are pushed or until we catch ourselves. And those little prejudices keep us from seeing the worthiness of all of God's children. But if we keep our sights focused on God and God's word and God's calling, God will help us to have open eyes and open hearts and open minds. God will call us to take that leap of faith that is needed to fully use the resources that we have been given to help those who need our help, so that everyone is seen and everyone feels worthy. And let me tell you, that message of worthiness desperately needs to be heard in this world today, in this church, in this community, in this school, in this state. We need to proclaim, you are worthy because you are a child of God. We need to believe, I am worthy because I am a child of God. And our worth can't be measured by dollars and cents. It can't be measured by toys. Can't be measured by clothes or the house we live in. God's children's worth are measured by the love of God and by the fact that he did send his son to die and to rise again so that we can find the faith and the strength to follow him. Amen.
Just a quick little announcement before we sing this song. My worth is not in what I own. If you take your bulletin out, I don't want to freak out the person running the PowerPoint. So if you follow along in your bulletin, my worth is not what I own. My worth is not in skill or name. And then the chorus. And then you'll see, as summer flowers, we fade and die. I will not boast in wealth or might. Then we're going to sing the chorus again. The final verse is, two wonders here, what I confess. And then we'll end the song by singing the chorus twice. And by the way, Pastor, you'll have to plunk 180, the hymn 180, The Spirit Intercedes Us.
Yeah. Okay.
Two sharps, C and F.
Okay. Please rise as you are able. Journeying together in trust and hope, we confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord.
He's conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit.
And born of the Virgin Mary, he suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body,
and the life of the
Amen. Amen. You may be seated. As we receive our offering, I thank you once again for your generosity in helping to support God's mission for this congregation and beyond. Come on forward, yep. Go ahead. Let us pray. Blessed are you, O God, maker of all things. Through your goodness, you have blessed us with these gifts, ourselves, our time, and our possessions. Use us and what we have gathered in feeding the world with your love. Through the one who gave himself for us, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Instead of doing, the Spirit intercedes for us. I will read the prayers and I will say, Lord, in your mercy, at the end of each petition. And if you would please respond, hear our prayer. Creator God, you call us to love and serve you with body, mind, and spirit through loving your creation and our sisters and brothers. Open our hearts in compassion and receive these petitions on behalf of the needs of the church and the world. Faithful God, you call your church to serve you. Free your people from the deceptions of false masters so that we discover the true richness of serving in your name. Lord, in your mercy. Creating God, you have made all kinds of creatures, protects animals in the midst of seasonal migration, whether by water, through the air, or over land. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Wise God, you rule the nations. when the powerful trample on the needy and take advantage of the poor, turn them from their selfish ways. Show us your ways of truth that lead to justice. Lord, in your mercy,
hear.
Healing God, you raise up those who have been brought low and you remember for the forgotten. We lift up to you all who are in need, especially those who are in need of healing. God, including Felix and Pastor Will, Jim and Larry, Rhonda and Peg, Virginia and Brenda, Carla and Sheila, Ron and Russell, Terry and Susan, Doris, Art and Jessica, Deanne, Joyce, Shell, Fred, Shelby, Gladys, Carla, and all of those others who, God, are struggling with health issues. God, we lift up to you communities that have been devastated by flooding and fires. We lift up to you those who are searching for lost loved ones that they may be found. We lift up to you those that are suffering from mental illness, including anxiety, depression, and hopelessness, and those who are suffering from physical illness and cancers. Grant them healing, God. Grant them joy and comfort in your presence. Be with their caregivers, God, that they might find strength and healing and peace and take care of themselves so that they're able to take care of others. Lord, in your mercy. Mothering God, you give us life. Give strength to families experiencing infertility or challenging pregnancies, to foster parents, parents of adopted children, single parents, and families of all varieties. Lord, in your mercy. Eternal God, you hold us close, even in death. We lift to you those who are mourning the loss of loved ones, including the family and friends of Torger and the SMNT community, the family and friends of Jake and the Custer and our community, the communities mourning the death of teenagers, including Woonsocket and Warner, and all, God, who are facing loss in so many ways. We give you thanks that we can cling to your promise, that you lift up those who have died and that you hold them in your hands, and that one day we will be reunited with all of them. And God, I lift up to you all of the rescue workers and searchers. It's been a tough, tough, tough fall and summer, God. So be with them and bring them peace. Lord, in your mercy. Holy One, hear our prayers and make us faithful stewards of the fragile beauty of this earth so that we may be entrusted with the riches of heaven. We pray this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and grant you his peace. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Before we sing our sending hymn, since we all got to go eat somewhere, how about if we do our table prayer? Come, Lord Jesus, be our guest, and let these gifts to us be blessed, and may there be a goodly share on every table everywhere. Amen. All right, we sing our closing hymn, Shine, Jesus, Shine. Hymn number 671.
Sorry, Pastor, I have no idea what the PowerPoint is versus the song, so just close your eyes and have fun.
Close your eyes and sing, and we'll go from there. Christ is sending you.
Thanks be to God.